Hi guys, Mr. Rain here, and welcome to the fifth and final Jurassic Challenge, the Southwest USA on Jurassic difficulty. So starting cash is 3 mil. There are wild dinosaurs to pick up, the physical traits, our greatly reduced dinosaur lifespan, and we'll get into that. The terrain is quite massive as well, and the cost of editing it is quite grievy as well. And here we have the standard thing that I do. I always put it onto lighting the second we get in there. So in total, this took 7 hours and 1 minute. There are a lot of things I would do differently, especially coming near the end of it. I spent a lot of time doing the lagoon, researching the reptiles, paying for the reptiles, and I didn't even use it. I got kind of ahead of myself. I was trying to plan too far ahead, and I went from 3.8, 3.9 stars to 5 stars in a very quick succession. And we're going to get into a lot of detail of this a little bit later. So as usual, guys, we're going to fire a lot of our scientists because they are way too expensive at the start of this. So fire those scientists straight away and get cracking on the first paddock. So a couple of other quick notes, guys. In the description, there's going to be a full timeline of the order of things is how I call it, or what I call it. And you can check down there as well if you want to. But please remember, if you do use the order of things in the text, do us a favor and leave the video playing on and silent, because that is how we earn the monies on YouTube. A couple of other things, I'll take us through it as we get to them. But I also have a Discord group on this game, guys. So if you want to chat or you need help on the game, it's a lot easier for me to help with screenshots. So send me an email from the description and I can send you a Discord link for that. Another thing is I do share play as part of my full-time job along with my channel. I've helped hundreds of people with thousands of trophies to date, and I have thousands of reviews as well. So if there is any game, guys, any game that you're having trouble with, any trophies, any platinums, you can email me from the description and I can send you a quote over and I can help you get those. And again, I have thousands of reviews I can show you as well. So over here, guys, we are going to go straight for the Chasmosaurus. Now these guys, you have to research, and again, I'm skipping a lot. We have to research those guys to actually top up those paddocks, but we will get into that a little bit later. So at the start here, while you're in the helicopter, I should actually be researching, and this came apparent to me. So in this one, we build 7 paddocks in total, and we only use 6 of them. Like I said before, I spent a lot of time and money researching the lagoon and the reptiles, and I didn't even get close to using them. I think in the end, what got me over the 5 stars was I had an offer to do the whole 1.5 times ticket sales, the cost of them, and that boosted my income, it boosted my profit per minute, and that really helped me towards getting the 5 stars a lot quicker than I should have gotten it. But in the end, I was ready to do the next paddock. I had everything set up, and then bang, the trophy just popped. So down here, guys, we've got the Nodosaurus. And again, we have to research these guys and excavate them to actually be able to top up the paddocks. But we're going to skip ahead. We're not going to show a lot of this. And I do show a lot more detail in this one than my previous two. Kind of like the first two I did. I was summarizing them too much. I had some comments, people saying it wasn't detailed enough. So this one, you're not going to miss a damn thing. Every single building I place, every single research, I will show. But the things like expeditions, when I start expeditioning for, let's say hypothetically, a Nodosaurus, then I'm only going to show that once. There's no point in me showing you continuously me excavating for Nodosaurus. And again, this was 7 hours and 1 minute, and I've got this video down to about 1.5 hours. And again, you're not going to lose out on any information at all. So at the start, guys, as per usual, we are going to get our first core buildings up. So restrooms and obviously the shelter. And as soon as possible, we want to get the power supply going so we can delete that. I actually did mess up. I restarted, I think, twice on this one because for some reason I just didn't build a hotel. I was like, why the hell this is not working? I wasn't getting any money. And then, of course, there's just one little building you forget to build. So skipping a little bit ahead here, and again, I do start, like I said, the first half an hour I do like 3 times. So all the buildings and everything I do is going to be the same, but there might be a different location of 1 or 2 of the buildings. So if there's inconsistency there, it's just because I've changed the location. So we did move the ranger station over there on the left-hand side of this paddock because we want that ranger station to be able to attend to the paddock that's going to be in the middle. And again, this kind of thing, knowing what I know now, I would build a paleomedical facility and a ranger station next to every single paddock that you build. I was trying to kind of share the ranger station, like the one on the top left over there. I was trying to share with the middle paddock I built just now. But I wouldn't do that. there, the traveling is too long, and there's a massive glitch where they can't travel around the edges of those mountains in the middle. I have to build fences around the mountains so the rangers could actually drive around them. And in the end, I just built more ranger stations and paleomedical facilities to counter that. So here, guys, as per usual, we're putting our amenities up, and we will be changing these amenities to the medium amenities as soon as humanly possible, because they will double the income. I got a comment yesterday on one of the channels. Oh, sorry, on one of the videos. Yeah, there, that's where I remind myself. Build a stupid hotel, John. So again, the amenities, guys, no brainer. Go through them. If it goes blue, then add them. You're gonna get more money through them. I will be doing, after this commentary, specific tutorials on the amenities, as well as the fencing and how to replace the fencing, and just various tips as well that I've learned through the many, many hours of gameplay. Yeah, what I was saying, I've got a tip saying that when the storms come and you open the shelters, it's actually sometimes advised to click on these shops, each of your amenities, and close them. Now, this is something I still have to put to the test. I do not know if it works, but apparently they don't lose any money when they're closed. They kind of just close. So you're losing money, but you're not going into the negative. So I'll have to check that out as well. So there, I loaded my game a little bit further back because I forgot to build a hotel, and I could have built the hotel way before. So as you can see, everything's pretty much in the same area. And again, I have to say that the ability to move buildings once they've been built is the best new feature of this game, because I move all these buildings away. All these buildings over here, they're all service buildings, so non-public buildings, and there's just no need for them to be anywhere near here. So I just find some corner of this map and I stash them all. So there we go. We have a slight rise, 199k on our first upgrade, or our first park increase. So again, with all these options here, guys, the contracts, I only ever choose, unless I didn't choose one there, I'm not sure what I chose there, but in the future, or doing it now, if I play it now, I would only ever choose contracts that will happen on their own. There's just no point in spending, I don't know, half an hour waiting for an Odysaurus to go to have a drink. But sometimes you can, you know, sometimes you can see it drinking and you can just do it. I'm just saying in general, I won't do any contracts that require me to do any extra effort. Unless it is required, unless it's like $1 million or something that you can get from there. So the Chasmosaurus is going lovely here. We're going to put the Chasmosaurus along with a Nodosaurus in here. And again, I will touch on it, but you want to keep topping them up. As you can see, I'm going for the Nodosaurus now, so I can put some more into that first paddock before we move on to the next one. Now, the first half of the game is very slow. I finished this in half the part time, or less than half the part time, so 14 and a half hours, and I finished in 7 hours. So the time doesn't really matter. At the start, I did a lot of fast forwarding because I wanted to keep the scientists right here very low. I didn't want to hire more scientists to speed things up. There's just no need to do that. And the whole aim here is to get profit per minute. And if you hire a scientist that has 60k, then you know that's gonna go down quite greatly. So another tip on the guest attractions. On my other videos, I was kind of berating them a little bit, saying I only built one guest attraction at the start. This is not the case anymore. I did a little test, and I will get into that later. I do show it. I build a little I call them little towns. Like next to each paddock, you've got your amenities, you've got your hotel, you've got your ranger stations and stuff like that. And if you put a guest attraction down to a group of amenities that are earning like 8k each, they will double. They will double in the profits, like within the first 4 or 5 minutes, even less. In the first minute, you will see the increased stats go up, bang, just like that. So the guest attraction is now part of my little town that I would build next to each paddock. And the innovation center as well is something I need to test. But the guest attraction really, really works. And that's why I researched for the first time the new guest modules. Excuse me. Okay, so here we go. We're going to get some extra cash in here. That's going to be quite a good one. The more species you have and the more dinosaurs you have, the greater the photo wealth. So at the start, I wanted to get just over that red mark. So desperately just want to start earning a profit. And then, you know, that's not even the biggest issue, starting to earn a profit. It's surviving the first storm. If you're able to survive the storm and then come back into the green after that, then you know you're kind of set, and you should be able to go from there. So here, this is my second paddock. And this is when we build the hatchery, the only hatchery we're going to have in the game, because space is very limited. Although I don't use half the space. I'm saying space as in this little area here where I want to build amenities and guest attractions, shelters and bathrooms. This is where you need to do it as tight as possible. Keep those pathways close to the buildings that you have. But again, being able to move the buildings really, really helps. So here we go. We haven't got up much from the last one, 7%. But the 214k per minute is what we want. And that is looking very, very good. Oh, here comes my cat. And she's going to run across the keyboard. There she goes. Hey, Feeny. Okay, so get your power going. That's the first paddock I build here. Oh, sorry, second. This is paddock two. And again, in the description, guys, you'll have a whole list of the paddocks and the dinosaurs I put in them. This one, I do a lot bigger because the Dilophosaurus, they require a very small area. And you can put a buttload of Dilophosaurus in here. I think I had almost 15, maybe 20 at one stage in there. And they were still 100% fine. And some of them do die with the negative effects of this map. If they have any physical or health ailments, the 90% reduction in a lifespan is quite brutal. But, you know, it's pretty much, you're able to research that out pretty quickly. You're able to do the genes and genetics to squeeze that out of their makeup. But they do die quite quickly. But after a couple, then they don't, you know. Then you start researching and doing the genetics and everything's fine. So here we go, relocate staff buildings. So over there, I built another paddock attached to paddock 2. And the staff buildings I wanted to put on the left-hand side. So we're going to go down here. We're going to fast forward this a bit. Make this a bit quicker. We put all our staff buildings over here. But we do another paddock just to the left of that paddock. You can see at the top there. But again, we will show this in a couple of seconds. Okay, so guest attraction is down. That's going to really boost the income of the surrounding amenities. So I'm all for those now. We're going to be expeditioning for Dilophosaurus. He will be the first. I don't think I've put any new Nodosaurus into the paddock, but Dilophosaurus, we're going to pump out as many as we can. This is where the negative physical traits come in on the Dilophosaurus and the Nodosaurus. Over there you can see the social trait, but that's okay. It's the health and combat traits that actually reduce their amount, I think it is. But there's only two of them that will reduce them. And to be honest, I mean, I mentioned it before, that it doesn't really pose a massive problem. You're able to click on those paths and pin the nodes that you need to research in order to get rid of those traits. Like you have to lose 3 fights or to get a dinosaur die of dehydration, you just leave them without water. So, I mean, the way to do it is pretty easy, but you have to know how to do it. So, as per usual, you would go to the genomes and then click on the research, or click on the button, it'll take you to the research that you need to do. Okay, so I do a couple of Nodosaurus before Dilophosaurus. So if you go over here, go to the negative trait, view research, push the X button, it's going to take you straight to the research, and then it'll tell you right there, release 2 dinosaurs with a sickly trait. So that kind of thing you have to do. So at the start, just release dinosaurs, play the game how you would play it. These kind of things will unlock El Natural. And also medicate 5 dinosaurs, obviously that's going to come into play naturally as well. So we want to get the medium amenities going as soon as possible. It's another building that I've put further up my starting queue because it's a profit per minute. That's what it is. You know, if you have more space in your amenities, then you're going to be able to have more profit per minute. So I delete all my small amenities and replace them with medium. So here's the first storm. The storms here, guys, all they do is stop the power. So that means your fences are safe, but your gates are not. Your gates are electric. So the gates are the only things that are going to be troublesome in these storms. My standard tip with this is, as I see right here, you want to go and reset that. I thought, what's happening here? But it's not about resetting that. It's just not working. I didn't realize at the time. But like in any storm, I'm just going to skip ahead there. Storm is gone. Nothing happened at all. So what I would normally do is repair the power and the ranger station last. Because even during the storm, okay, not this storm because the power's gone anyway. I'm saying on a general storm, you still have access to both of those ranger stations that you can control, not manually, but automatically send them over. But if you repair the ranger station or the power first, then you have to manually control them. So wait until the storm is finished to repair the power stations and the ranger stations on any other map. This map, you lose the power anyway, so you have to do it manually. Okay, Dilophosaurus. I love the contrast of their skin colors on the sand. Okay, those are the first 3 that we're going to release. And we release a buttload more than that. So the terrain, adding terrain and moving the terrain around and adding food, and adding, well, I'm saying for the herbivores, adding food and adding water is extremely expensive. So when you would normally go and add your water to a paddock like this, just, you know, push the X button once, bunk, push it once, and then see how much water they need. But do not go there and like do water and add rocks and change the gradient. Don't do anything, which is why they look so crap. I mean, I still do it because I was bored at one point and I had the cash, but there's no need to change anything. Just get them comfortable and then walk away. That's all it is, because it's extremely expensive. So there we go. 1-star rating. There we go. So it's 14 minutes in the video. I'm not sure what timing it is on the actual game. There we go, 1 hour 16. So it took a bit longer, but there's no need for rushing on this at all. 6 hours more and I've got the 5 stars. So here we go. Amenities are going down at the second paddock area. And again, guys, you can check the description for the order of things, as I like to call it. And also, like I mentioned before, I'm going to be doing tutorials on the amenities and the fencing after this. And then I'm going to play some Phoenix Point after I get the platinum for this. I'll do the platinum achieving as well for this. I want to show you how I got my last dinosaurs and everything and how to find them. And I'll have a video up for that as well by the end of today. Not very long ones. I'm so used to these 2, 3, 4 hour videos. So it'll be nice to do a couple of short ones. But here we go. We've got the 3 medium amenities and restrooms and shelter. And I do try, I think, and get the guest attraction in here, but I'm not sure if I manage to do it. I have to move some buildings around. And again, the biggest tip I can give for this, like I said at the beginning, is every paddock you build, like I built 2 on the left-hand side over there, you've got to have their own ranger station, their own paleo medical facility, because as I mentioned before, they have a lot of trouble getting around the mountains. They will go out of bounds and then they'll just blow up. They won't even like they'll get stuck and then they'll just blow up. But I do touch on that a little bit later. Okay, Nodosaurus having one egg is a bit of a ball kick. A kick to the nuts there, only having one egg, but this is the way it is. Again, I was just having a look at what research we need, but it's the same. Release sickly trait and medicate dinosaurs. I don't know why I just didn't pin it, but I think at this point I need to. I probably incubated more or synthesized more because we've got to get the sickly trait out. That guy is super expensive. Then we're going to go jump ahead and we're going to put a hotel right smack bang against this paddock here. I was lucky to be able to get the pathway through there. I haven't even turned the game on since the update, so I couldn't even tell you what it is or what differences they've made. I think now the one that the subscriber told me is that you can have different skins on dinosaurs in one batch, so you can assign different ones to different eggs, I think. That's pretty cool, but I mean normally I just have a different skin for each batch that I do, so nothing too big at all there. Okay, we want the tour rides, guys. Uh-oh, here comes the cat again. We want the tour rides going because the guests that the luxury guests and adventure guests, they have tour rides, the gyrospheres and the, well, the tour rides, Jurassic Tours. So here comes the third paddock. This is paddock 3. And if you hear bumping now, it's just the cat knocking the microphone. Sorry about that. She's being a bit of a needy kitty now. Yeah, so this is paddock 3. And in here, we're going to have the Kentrosaurus and the Matabatosaurus, I think it is. And we're going to have a lot of them in there because the areas are a little, the gaps are a little bit bigger than you think they are. And when you start building the paddock, you realize this. So now we're going to move all the staff buildings down here, guys. We're going to move anything that isn't guest related. We're going to put into this area the science building, even the control center, the science center. You saw I moved it there. Staff centers as well. I'm going to put them all the way down the side of this area here because this area we do not use. And you can use the thin paths here if it's not, you know, guest related. We're going to free up some space here. We're going to move this paleo facility closer to this paddock, but facing this direction, so he can still get to paddock number one. And I do place another one a little bit later. And we will get into that as well because they kind of need the only ones, like I've been saying. So that leaves you with some room over here because the amenities, I think they're getting quite maxed out. So at the time, I was like, everything's fine, but now we need to get the shelter and the restrooms out. So let's have a look at what we do here. We're going to put the shelter over there. And again, this is where I want to put the monorail at some point. You've got to leave some space there for the monorail. For now, we'll just do the shelter right there and then keep checking your amenities, guys. I don't show it. You've got to keep checking your amenities, making sure they are getting the monies they need. And there is a nice incubation or a nice synthesis. Loads of eggs, 7 of 7 eggs for me right there. Bring it on. All right, let us see what we do next. Again, if you're hearing a bit of bumping on the microphone, the cat is actually scratching against it now, and she does what she wants. She's the queen. Okay, now we've done paddock 2, and those paddocks, I do increase the size of them both those paddocks, and I put a paleo facility on the other side of that paddock because it's getting a bit crowded here. So just once or twice, I'm going to show you the amenities, just reminding you to go back and have a look at them, because that is the bread and butter. Unfortunately, the game, like I say in the other video, should be called amenity management. But there are some dinosaurs involved. And here come a couple now. So, Dilophosaurus, different skin, as I said before, I just choose a different skin every batch. Works pretty well. And I really hope they've ironed out some of the other glitches for this game. There's a lot of problems with the paleomedical facility glitching out. When you try and get a dinosaur out, it won't pick up the dinosaur and put it back in the paddock, and then you can't use it, you can't delete it. It's just absolutely, it's terrible. Happened in my previous map, but I just had to build another one next to it. That's all I could do, really. And if you're lucky enough to have the space, then you got the space. Okay, Ranger Outpost is going right there between paddock 3 and 4. Sorry, 2 and 3. 2 and 3. So we have the Science Center and Staff Center down there. We're going to put some more service buildings down there. The tour rides, I had a look at earlier. We want to get this going. Because, I put the viewing gallery as well as a tour ride on each of them. Just to cater for more guests or different types of guests. You should put the viewing gallery, viewing platform, and one of the tour rides, the Gyrosphere or the tour Jurassic Tours. Then you cater for all the guests on one paddock, which is pretty good. Having a look at the excavation there, let's move it forward. Okay, we're doing fine on the amenities, and we're going to check these ones out here. We've got the guest attraction. See here, 200, 200, and 200. So those, I'm actually losing money now because there isn't enough space for those guests. So what do we do straight away? The amenity swap. We're going to place down the three medium amenities now. Now, normally I would delete the other ones and put them in their places, but I had enough space here to do it separately. So put them down. Now, don't get deterred by the stats once you put this down. Like if I click on that building there now, the stats are going to be really crap. That's just because the other one is already there. The other one hasn't been deleted yet. So depending on what happens with the stats, if it's like over there, it's overflowing. Yeah, we'll gain 2 million. Thanks for that. Definitely. If the stats plummet on one of them, then just delete one of them and just have the medium amenity. But some of the time, you'll be able to keep the small amenity as well as the medium amenity, which is what I think I do here. And that would make sense since the small amenities are maxed out at 200 guests. Then the other guests have got to go somewhere. So as you can see, 320, then over here, still got 200 guests in those. And then bang, minus 10,000 on that one. So we delete that one straight away because this one is operational. So it looks like we're going to have to delete them. I do place more down earlier. When the medium ones get full and you place large ones down, then they seem to stick around. But let's see over here. Shopping's 200 and 200. We're waiting for that one to finish building. Bang, 25,000 straight away. Oh, 7,000. See, that jumped. Oh, wow. I showed an extraction. So Kentrosaurus and the Mutterbuttosaurus are going to go into the same paddock. Just another quick reminder, guys, if you're having trouble with any games at all, as I mentioned before, I do share play as part of my full-time job. It's becoming my full-time job very quickly. So if you're having trouble with any trophies anywhere, I've even done full playthroughs of Jurassic Park 1 or Jurassic World 1 Evolution. Quite efficient at a lot of the difficult trophies out there. So email me from the description if you're having trouble with any trophies at all, and I will get back to you as soon as humanly possible. So here we go. We're still having a look at the trait. There we go. We're able to research it, but we just need the resources. And we can get rid of that sickly trait and the minus 90% on the lifespan. Thanks for playing. So we're going to pop out some more Dilophos. No, we're going to wait. No, we are synthesizing one there. Okay, back to paddock one. I put this it is the right way around. I thought it was the wrong way around. Make sure that you put the photo bombs down over here, as well as making sure that the amount of vehicles is set to the maximum of 10, because you'll be able to cater for a lot more guests. I still don't know what effect these photos have. Those are photo points that take photos of the guests, just the same as like a roller coaster you go on. You'll get a picture taken of yourself. I don't know what the difference is or what it does, but it's there, so might as well use it. I always thought it was a part when I first played the game, like where you can kind of not get out of your vehicle, but like on the tour rides, you can take photos of dinosaurs from that point, like a good photo point. But I was very, very wrong. It's photos taken of you. So again, let's have a look around here. So we got 200 on that. We need another amenity, another medium amenity. to cater for that one. It does bug me a little bit that you know, it's perfectly set up here, but you can't put an amenity on the other side of the path because that building's got some sort of I don't know, some sort of terrain malfunction. But sometimes you can have a shop or a building in a completely hollow area and it won't go down. The first thing I do is check for water, because water is the stopper of buildings. Okay, we're going to have a quick look at the amenities here. Still not earning as much as I would like, but that's because we only have one dinosaur species in this paddock. They will greatly increase the profits when you put more dinosaurs in. So as you can see here, we're going to incubate some more Dilophosaurus, which is what we want. We need to get large hotels and transport up as soon as possible. Oh, looks like we've got the transport going. Monorail, Simpsons, monorail. So part-time is 14 and a half hours. Yeah, so we're an hour and a half in, and we're looking good. Coming up to 1.5 stars. I don't know, it looks like I didn't change the skin on that one. Bad. Although I don't think it makes any difference. Maybe the variety or the appeal will go up slightly. Oh, I forgot to mention. Okay, this is just me putting down the monorail. I finished this 5-star run with an appeal of 52%. Now, this was a very strange thing to see, because I thought the goal was you need so many species, you need so many visible dinosaurs, you need so much appeal, and then you'll get the profit per minute. But none of that matters. None of those percentages matter at all. They matter for you creating money and a running park that's actually profitable. Sure, yes. But as I show later on, I had 52% of the required appeal total, and I got 5 stars because the profit per minute went up massively. So that's just something for you to know and to understand, that appeal rating is something that you could go for to drive you, but it's not something you need to get the 5 stars. It's just profit per minute, so, you know, amenity management. And it's good to know, but it still drives you in the right direction going for that appeal, because the appeal brings people in, which puts people in the amenities, and it all trickles over. So we moved that monorail down to this side over here, and this is where we're going to build our next little area. We're going to have 2 paddocks down here. Let's see what this is all about. Incorrect materials, whatever. Click yes, let's go. And we're going to have 2 more paddocks down there. And that's going to be 1, 2, 3, 4, paddock 4 and 5 I've got here, yes. We're going to have the Carnotaurus and the Mojangosaurus separately, guys. The previous map, I was speaking to the Jurassic World Twitter account, and they were kindly replying to me. And I was like, I could put out the Ceratosaurus, and it says the Allosaurus or the Albertosaurus, one of the two, can cohabitate, or they are friendly with each other. Liars! Again, the carnivores do not go well together. In this whole, I don't know how many 100 hours of playing this game so far, there is only 2 dinosaurs that I've cohabitated that are carnivores, and that's the Baryonyx and the Suchomimus. They are happy together, completely fine. If you put too many of them in a paddock, sure, they're going to get antsy and they're going to fight like any dinosaurs. If your dinosaurs are fighting often, it's because there's too many in there. If they start fighting, if I have two fights in one paddock, I'll sell one of them straight away, and the fights just disappear. Sometimes if they get sick or they have an ailment, they'll fight as well. But if they fight and then wander apart, it's just because there's too many in the paddock. Wow. Oh, okay, I showed the storm save. So again, the storms, guys, they suck. And if you have enough money to get through them, then you're going to be fine. But remember to take photos of your dinosaurs if you're coming close to the end, because if the month ends and you're in the red, that's game over. It doesn't matter if it happens now or 5 minutes from now. If it ends, the month ends, and you're in the red, it's done, which is a bit weird. It should be a month from when you start going in the red, but it's not the case. So, again, just fly around in your helicopter, pause the game, make sure you repair any gates first. All you want to do is look for gates. Don't give an F about anything else. Just look for gates. Once the gates are, see there, there's a gate right there, and that guy is going to repair it right now. So, the storms are not too bothersome in this, and I know I say that with a pinch of salt, because a lot of people get destroyed by the storms, but it's all about having enough capital and having enough profit per minute to be able to handle the storm and to get out of the red once the storm blows over. And that is something you're going to strive for anyway. So if you can survive the storm and still able to get the profit back up, then you should be fine. Just remember to open those shelters and potentially close the amenities. Again, I haven't tried this. I know I mentioned it earlier. But maybe close the amenities and you won't lose the money. You'll just lose the amount that they wouldn't put in there if they were in there, if that makes sense. So closing them don't lose profit. You just stand stalemate. So that's 19. Was it a negative amount there? I'm not sure. But as you can see, it costs a lot of money to fix buildings. And of course, on this map, there is no building upgrades, which is devastating because all I wanted to do is put a storm defense in the power station. And of course, getting to the game, you read no building upgrades is a bit of a dick punch. But we get through it. There's no increased capacity on the fossils, and that sucks because it costs $1 million. But to go from 7 fossils extraction to 17 for the same amount, for the same price, is something I do very early on for all games or maps. There we go, park rating increased. Let's go, baby. We are motoring forward here. We've only got about an hour left on the tutorial, and we're going to have 5 stars up and running in no time. So at 2.5 stars is the point when a lot of other things unlock, like the concrete fencing. And again, I want to show a tutorial on that after this. I want to show my platinum, how I got the platinum, or how I'm going to get the platinum today, as well as the fencing and some amenity tutorials on top of that. So let's see what we're doing next. We've got the Kentrosaurus, Nodosaurus, Dilophosaurus. So the Kentrosaurus is going into the paddock next to the Dilophosaurus. So that's paddock 3. Let me check. Yeah, Kentrosaurus and Matabatosaurus. So that is what we're excavating for now. And again, I'm not going to show it more than once, just to let you know. This is the kind of thing I was kind of missing in the previous video. I just released the Kentrosaurus instead of showing you that I was expeditioning for it. And then people were saying, oh, I didn't know that you expeditioned for that half an hour ago. So that's why I changed it. And I'm showing the excavations now, or the expeditions. So these are service buildings, so we don't need fatty paths. Although we do have one, why didn't I edit that out? We do have one path going down here to the next area, which some people still want to use instead of using the monorail. So here we go. Kentrosaurus, so we got weak trait. I don't think there was a requirement for the weak trait release, but weak is fine, you know. Any ailment they have now, just release them, because there's going to be some research somewhere that requires you to release the dinosaur with some sort of negative ailment. So at the start, just release them. 100% just release them, and it'll help with the research. Okay, here we go. Viewing platform. Again, I don't think I researched it yet, but to get some more different guest types within one paddock area, just would build all the viewing platforms. And I stick with the gyrospheres from now on. I won't do any more tour rides because they just get eaten up and destroyed by dinosaurs. I don't think I've ever had a problem with the gyrospheres themselves. Wow, that was a big sneeze. I gave the cat a fright. Okay, let's see what we're doing next, guys. We have the Kentrosaurus. So we're going to airlift these guys into the next paddock right there. And they're going to be happy, happy, happy in there. And this kind of thing, guys, just for the over the course of the game, you just keep topping up. I don't show it all the time, but keep topping up the dinosaurs that you do have. So release those Dilophosaurus all the time. Release the Kentrosaurus, as well as the Matabatosaurus, which we put in there. Top up the Nodosaurus and the Chasmosaurus from the first paddock. If one dinosaur dies, I normally top it up with 3 or 4 more, because you know that a couple more are going to die at the same time, around the same time. You have your death sprees, because they're incubated at the same time, obviously. Except the wild ones. And you can check the age of them if you want to. Okay, so we're powering the monorail down there to the right. And we've still only got 3 dinos available here, which is fine. We're going to do some more Kentrosaurus before we do the Matabatosaurus. Although I'll probably do it in a different order now. I'll do the Matabara before pumping out more Kentro. And with the short money I've got there, I probably would do that just to get different species. And that's not... Oh, was that a red amenity there? I think it was. That's no good. So shopping over there, 375. We're going to put another one over here. I could have sworn I did that earlier. On the right. Oh, we do have. So we're going to see how many we got there. So 135, 155, 178 over there. That's fine. We will do that. And you can check on the bottom left corner the projected guests for each one. For a large amenity, over 130 or 150 is okay. Medium amenity, anything above 95 or 100. And the small amenity, anything above 60 or 70, will start making a profit. But again, I don't show the medicating and the treatments of the dinosaurs. There's just no need for all that shit, because that's something you'll do in natural anyway. Okay, so here we have paddock 4 and paddock 5. We're going to do one big one in that corner and then slice them in twine just like that. There we go. So again, go easy on the terrain adjustments and the water and everything else, because it costs a bucket load to actually do that. That's one thing. I think if I could change one thing about this game, or to add one thing about this game, let's have a look there, park rating, yeah. It would be, you send a paleomedical van to analyze the ailment of a dinosaur, like you saw right there. Then I had to go back and tell him to medicate the dinosaur. Why wouldn't they, if they have the antidote to the ailment the dinosaur has, why wouldn't they just do it straight away? It seems like a bit of a repeated step that you have to go back, and a lot of the time the paleomedical van is gone all the way back to its base by the time you get back to it. So why wouldn't they, okay, this animal's got the avian flu, we have the vaccine, let's dart it straight away. But no, you have to go back there and tell them to dart it again. And I feel that is something that seems a bit lazy. And it probably works for the beginning of the game, because there's certain things that you have to go back and you have to unlock it. But once the ailment or the vaccine is unlocked, then they should just automatically apply it if they go there and the dinosaur has that particular ailment. Okay, this here now, I would probably go around the left of this mountain, guys, and attach it on this side over there, because that's what we do at the end. We delete a whole lot of stuff. And this is what the trick I like to do with my monorail. If you watch my other videos, then you know, normally I would, attach them straight away once building them. And we're going to go staff improvements one there. But now I like to build the whole monorail and then just leave it detached from the one that's working. And then just simply attach that once it's completed. It'll significantly reduce the time that your transport rating takes a knock. Okay, increased number of guests. Don't lose your scientist. I don't think I've ever lost a scientist, as in, I'm not even sure how they get lost. I'm assuming they'll quit if you overwork them. But as you can see there, I've got the monorail just over here. That's where I'm going to attach it to the other one, but I'm going to let this one construct first, because it takes a long time. Again, no need to have the fat path on the service buildings, but there is a fat path going down there. I think I do change it. Let's see what I do now, having a look at the power. Let's see what's wrong with him. No, we don't need to see. So Kentrosaurus, we're still pumping those out into this paddock here. And we've got the gyrosphere and the viewing gallery set up right there. Okay. Let's see what else we got here. Okay, the Mutamutosaurus is what is next. I like the green for some reason. I always do the green ones. Loads of fun. And we're going to be unlocking all of the platforms, all of these skins today. I'll probably get the platinum trophy today, but what I'm doing, or what I have done, is I've got a save game for all the completed Jurassic difficulties, and I'll just go back and load those games and then research everything and do all the sickness and release all the dinosaurs and excavate for all the dinosaurs to unlock all the databases. So as you can see here, this is me in action with the just connecting the last two remaining tracks. And greatly reducing the time, like I said, that your transport rating takes a knock. So, Mutamutosaurus is getting down here now. Oh, sorry. Yeah, there's Kentrosaurus still. And these guys are going to be fine. Excuse me. These guys are going to be happy in there, and they're going to eat the same food as the Mutamutosaurus. So that's all good. That's another thing I've realized, is the cohabitation, sure, dinosaurs like this dinosaur, they can live with this dinosaur, but in the end, the restriction is the food. If there isn't enough surface area to put the amount of food that they need, then there's no point in having those dinosaurs together. It's better to make another smaller paddock on their own. And that's something I came into a realization on my previous map, is there's no need to try and put as many dinosaurs as you can into one paddock, but if they eat the same food, then go wild, because then you could have a normal sized paddock with four species in, which is what I was going to do on the final paddock of this run. I think I had three or four species I was going to put into one paddock. I think it was the Olerotitan, Ankylosaurus, and the Stegosaurus I was going to put in one paddock. But it was a big one as well, so I wasn't worried about the food. I was just going on the cohabitation. Here we go, putting down some photobombs. I don't know why I call them photobombs, I just do. And that is going to go through the Carnotaurus and the Mojangosaurus paddocks separately. Separately. Again, the only dinosaurs I'm ever going to put together, carnivore-wise, is the Suchomimus and the baryonyx. So here, that's me reminding myself that the lagoon, do not do the lagoon. If you want to, sure, guys, I'm just saying, if you're going to follow this, what I did, research the fences first. Although the fences don't get broken in storms, they do not use power and they are the strongest fence. So in essence, in any other map, they would have two benefits. In this map, it's just because they don't use power, and this is reduces your power cost and increases your profit per minute in the end. Slightly, maybe 20, 30k, but still, you know, how many maps I've done where I've been 10k short of 5 stars and I haven't been able to get it. Every little helps. So we've got a lot of stuff going on there. Going back, checking out our Nodosaurus and the Chasmosaurus they're fighting in that first paddock. Let's see what's up next. Black market dinosaur, take the money and run. See, the Matamatosaurus egg costs what, like 38k? That is a definite profitable deal right there. We will have it. So there was a long period where there wasn't a single sickness in this park. Like, I'm talking about an hour, even longer. And then suddenly, whoop, there was this wave of sickness. I couldn't even keep up with the treatment. I had to build more paleomedical facilities.
Surprise.
And again, we don't use
This
any of
is
the space down south, although I do build a lagoon there, which I never use. I literally build a whole lagoon and don't ever use it. I just do one more paddock before it, and the trophy popped. So we have large electric fence, and we need to wait for 2.5 stars before we can research the concrete fence.
Very
So
hectic.
at the time being, I like to build another paddock like I did on the right-hand side there. Once that paddock is set up, then I come back to my first paddocks and spend the money on topping up dinosaurs, making sure I've got as many as I can in these ones before I actually excavate, or sorry, expedition for the new ones. So let's have a look here. What are we going for, John? We look at inoculations. I didn't realize this in my first couple of gameplays, but the research on the right-hand side over there, the four on the right, or was it five, four? Those are inoculations. So if you get to that point and you research that, then you'll never have that disease again in your park. So that should be your goal, especially on a park where dinosaurs are sickly like the one before this. It's something I would focus on more, is getting the inoculations, and you can save yourself hours. So we're going for the Chunkingosaurus and the Hyangosaurus. Strangely enough, I put the Hyangosaurus and the Imagosaurus in a paddock on the left-hand side, and the Imagosaurus is a sauropod, so he's kind of like the brachy, and yet his space requirements and his paddock requirements are like half of the Hyangosaurus. I had a massive paddock, and I couldn't get the Hyangosaurus up to 100% because he wouldn't wander down to the area where I increased the size. But we'll get into that a bit later. So here we go, avian pox inoculation. You want to do these as cheap as they are, and the cost of them is not the problem. It's getting to the point to unlock them because they are requirements you have to do. That's something to keep note of. Maybe keep a little note on the side that once you do those inoculations, then bang, you know, the disease is no longer existing in your park, and that is just fantastic because, let's be honest, you spend 40% of your time sorting out dinosaur ailments. So here we go. We're doing the paddock. Let's see, three and four. No, sorry, four and five. I've got in the description. And we're going to get the larger amenities going as soon as possible because I wanted to research the fencing before I'd build the next paddock. But as you can see, I'm still far away from 2.5 stars, so I need to get it going. And I do have a way of adding those fences now without having to trank all the dinosaurs. So that's good. Okay, so we are doing the Carnotaurus. The metal dinosaur, as Owen says, but I think I do put one or two too many in this paddock because they do fight quite a bit, and at the time I didn't realize that I should just sell one. So this is me increasing the size. I was gonna start replacing the fencing, then I realized I have the space over here. Let's just increase the size of these paddocks, and I do increase them a lot more a bit later because I just don't use the space. But as you can see, this is now concrete, and I do come all the way further back, and this is how you replace it, guys. This is my what tutorial on the fencing is going to be. Use the concrete on the electric fencing just like this, and you do not have to trank the dinosaurs or delete the, oh, you don't have to trank the dinosaurs and lose a lot of money trying to fix them. It doesn't matter how short the as you can see there, I just skipped ahead. I did that all the way around the entire paddock, and once it's built, then you can go around and very carefully save your game first, very carefully delete the electric fencing next to the concrete, as you'll see right here. That's easy enough to delete right there, but you'll see how careful I am when you come down to the deleting of both. Like over here, you want to be able to delete just the one, There's no confirmation box or anything, but over here we can delete the fencing and leaving the concrete right there, and that is how I now do it. Not like Jurassic World Evolution 1, where you can literally just replace and it's instant. If you had to replace the fencing here with concrete, it's the same as deleting your fence. Literally, you won't have a fence around the paddock for ages. And I learned that the very hard way the first time I did that. I replaced all the fencing in a paddock and there was just dinosaurs rampant in my park. I don't know what the hell was going on, but it's not like the first game. So down here, guys, like I said before, I start building Paleo Medical and the ranger station next to each paddock, dedicated for that paddock. There's no need to try and do it differently. Okay, guys, we're going on to our first summary mode. This means I'm only going to show things that I haven't shown before. I'm only going to show things once, kind of like the whole video so far, but a little bit more summarized. So I'm going to show new buildings that I've done, and new research, and the new paddocks I'm building, as well as the once I'll show the expeditions. But other than that, it's pretty much the same as what's been happening, and we'll go on to super summary mode a bit later. So I'm kind of edging towards the large amenities. I would definitely do that now. I don't know why I was hesitant, because I've got new areas coming up and we want to just put down the larger amenities without having to swap out the medium ones a bit later. So at the beginning here, guys, we're going to move buildings around. Any service building we do not need over there at all, we're going to put over here, so there's space for amenities or more amenities or guest attractions, just space for guest things pretty much near the first paddock. So this area over here I use as like an industrial area, if you will. Okay, so we got the hotel over there, and we're going to move him a little bit further up just so we can add some more amenities, because looking at the amenities I've got there, they're all full, including the large ones. So there's wasted guests there, if you will. And I don't think I've built amenities this close together before, because they normally take the guests from the one. But having 200 overcrowded guests and amenity over here at the start, I was like, where's the hotel? Oh, I moved it. Muppet. I realized that you can actually have amenities of the same type pretty close together, and they can still be full. And this is Exhibit A right here. As we will see, we want to fast forward. Let's have a look. Oh, that's someone. Dexosaurus Thunder. Still need 3 dress challenge modes. We're taking my time with it. There we go. Thanks, buddy. Thanks for the support. Give you a shout out to Mr. Dexosaurus Thunder. Okay, here we go, guys. Our first 3 Carnotaurus is coming in. Are coming in. And got to be very careful with what you do. See the sand. That was almost 50, 60k for that one little set of sand. But they like sand and rock. The rock's the same. That's fine. It's just changing the terrain. That is very, very costly. So that's going to be fine for the Carnotaurus, obviously with a live feeder right there. And now, again, I would make these paddocks bigger. Although they worked absolutely... Oh, excuse me, I'm burping. They worked absolutely fine with what I've got here. But considering the amount of space that I didn't use in the end, it wasn't really that there wasn't enough space there. It was having enough space for the paddock and the amenity buildings and the service buildings next to it. So the Mojangosaurus, guys, I've changed my opinion on the aggressive stance with them. If they're aggressive, if they're antisocial, it does not matter. Put them in the paddock. If they're fighting or something, and they're continuously fighting, then sell them. I was looking into that because, oh, look at that, 346k a minute. I was looking into that in the previous maps because I was trying to get carnivores to cohabitate. And they didn't tell me straight. They're kind of beating around the bush saying that they can't. So I was like, okay, so why in the likes and dislikes tab of their... of their details, does it say that they can live together or they like each other when they're just going to kill each other? And again, they didn't give me like a straight answer. I was like saying, it's very misleading. You know, why do you have that when you know that they're going to kill each other? Why do you have that in there? And I think it was kind of like, okay, I'm actually quite curious to see if maybe the update changed that. But as a general rule of thumb, no carnivores except the two that I keep mentioning, Baryonyx, Suchomimus, I will ever try and cohabitate, which means that it makes it kind of easier. When it comes to carnivores, you just build a paddock and throw them in. And I don't even think it matters on the size of the paddock. If there's a certain number together, then they'll start fighting. I'm not sure if it has something to do with the area that they have to roam. Okay, so let's see what we're doing next, guys. We've got a couple of Mojangosaurus is up next. So he's the next one. They're very expensive. Almost 3 million or something, or 2.5 million for 3 eggs. And we got them coming across right now. So as you can see, a lot of time passed. fast-forwarding, sorting out sick ailments and dinosaurs, but I've shown you everything new that I've done. So here we go. We still want to do the viewing platform, or do we? And eventually I'll do the extra guest modules for the guest attractions, because like I mentioned before, I'm an advocate of the guest attraction now, and I'll show that exactly what happens as I place it on the next paddock where I put my Baryonyx, one of my favorite dinosaurs. And from there, we're on the home stretch, really. Only got about 40 minutes left on the video, packed with information and the cohabitations of the next ones. Again, I only put two species in each paddock, but I did have three species lined up for just below this paddock here. And again, I will go into detail. So this is area 3. This is with the Carnotaurus. I'm having a look at the amenities and the overcrowding. They seem to be okay. I mean, 23k a minute for a large one with only two species in the area. That's not too bad. There we go. 3 stars. Bring it on. Woohoo! Shake the camera, John. So, these guys were way less irritable. The guy's chasing a goat. So these guys are way less irritable than the Carnotaurus. I think it's because I had more in here than I did of the Mesangosaurus on the right. But they do fight quite a bit, and I do have to repair their ailments quite a few times. But here we go. We have the Chunkingosaurus. Oh, sorry, it was the Hyangosaurus. I don't use the Chunkingosaurus. Let's see what I need for platinum down here. I've got things needed for plat. I need one dig site. I need one power station from the Jurassic Park era. I need the Chunkingosaurus, Corythosaurus, Cryolophosaurus, I haven't heard of that, the Dryosaurus, Iguanodon, obviously, the Pentaceratops, and the Dicentosaurus. Those are the only things I need for Platinum Trophy. I spent Friday morning going through the, because you could see the picture of the dinosaur that you need. You just go online, look for an index of the dinosaurs, and you have to just go by the picture of which one you're missing. It didn't take very long at all, and again, I'll release a video today. I'm working all day today, and release some more videos on getting the platinum and some tutorials. Just things I wish I'd known at the start, that kind of thing. Okay, so we're going to put some fences down here, and we do end up increasing the size of that paddock because the Hyangosaurus, again, I'm not going to use him again. I'd rather use a different ceratopside because that's his species. Because his needs are just ridiculous. If I can put a Brachiosaur in there and he's happy compared to a small dinosaur, then no, I'm not doing it. So here we go. This is me replacing the fencing again. No need to show it, but I do it with all the paddocks because it reduces your power usage, which reduces your monthlies and increases your profit per minute. Okay, so I don't know what that half thing was there. What was that? I started getting irritated and bored of looking at all the crap, just plain sand paddocks. I just wanted to make it green and get in there and make it look nice, but there's just no need. And how much it costs extra, you know, I wait for the sandbox mode in order to do that. I want to do a large sandbox mode on the desert area, probably San Diego, and then just use a whole lot of green and water in there as well. Super excited to get started on that. Site manager sick, whatever. Lose the money, get it sorted. We don't want to have riots. Okay, so we've got a hotel coming in there. Path him up, power him up, and let's move on. What is going to be next is the question. Okay, just over 3 stars. 1 million profit per minute. This is before expenses, obviously. Diversity, amenities can earn more. Again, amenities is just something that's going to happen over time. But as you can see there, amenities are full. So you've got to be careful with that. If your amenities are at max capacity, then that's as much as they're going to earn. Try and sneak in another small amenity next door or something like that to cater for the overcrowded guests. And make sure you've got the wide paths outside your amenities as well. That also helps with overcrowding. And at this point, I just thought to get some photos in because you've got a lot of different species that you can have in one shot. And you can earn hundreds of thousands. As you can see there, one photo is like 3 minutes wait in-game. You go down to the Carnotaurus and the Mesangosaurus, take a photo of both of them, and it'll be over 300,000 for that photo easily. So again, I just put a little thing in here showing you that you can earn a lot of extra money, as you can see here. I don't think this is a good one. It's too far away. Yeah. If you get in closer, you'll have a whole lot of Matamatosaurus and Dilophosaurus. So carnivores and herbivores. This should be a good one right here. Yeah, you can see how quick it goes up. Look at that. 250,000. Thank you. This would be my job. And 100%. This or Let's see, a Compsognathus handler. One that I can have running around the house all the time and then eat me. Okay, Carnotaurus and Hyangosaurus are incubated, or sorry, are synthesized. And as you can see, guys, I'm only using four scientists this whole time. There's a lot, so much time that I'm fast-forwarding in between, waiting for these guys to be rested and stuff like that. But it's very difficult to keep that profit per minute up. I was taking too long, and I just went on a firing scientist spree. I looked at what I needed to do next. I looked at the genetics and everything like that I needed for them, and I deleted or fired the scientists that I didn't need and just kept the bare essentials. So there again, there's another reminder for me to say, if you're following this guide step by step, do not build a lagoon. I mean, I could have done this an hour and a half, maybe even more, quicker. This over here, I put the lagoon. It fits quite nicely over there, actually. I was quite amped for it. But over here, I do one paddock I don't even use. Over here, I use the Baryonyx, and I was going to do the Suchomimus, but I don't even get to that. The five star popped. And then just to the left over here is where I do a big paddock over here. I build this whole area up. Over here, I don't use. Over here, I don't use. Excuse me. But just a bit further up there, I do the where I was going to do the three species right there. I was going to do the, well, I'd do the Alora Titan and then the trophy pop. So I was going to put, like I said, Stegosaurus and the Ankylosaurus in there. A good three species combination, but they do eat different food, so you got to be careful. So at this point, I moved the other paleo facility over here so he can tend to this paddock as well as paddock one, which is just on the left-hand side of this mountain. And over here is where I had the issue of the trucks getting stuck on the side of the mountain where that white line is on the left-hand side. And again, I'll show you a bit later how I dealt with that. And I thought building the fence would work. And then I came back to it at one stage, and he was kind of stuck against the fence as well. So I was like, well, that didn't help at all. But I don't remember seeing a van going past there. It just took him such a long time to get to this paddock. That's why I couldn't stress. I did say at the beginning, just do a paleo medical and recovery station for every paddock. Save yourself the trouble. They cost nothing. So do it on this, on the other side of the paddocks if you can. It's not always going to have the space. But the amenities and the guest attractions on the one side, and the other side, the service buildings. That's how I'm going to kind of set up all my parks from now on, is to do that, have one side of it where possible. You're not always going to have the space, so you might have to share them sometimes. But as you can see there, I've got a paleo medical facility at the bottom. I'll show that again in a second. But here we are setting up the Amargrosaurus and the Hyangosaurus paddock. And this is going to be paddock. Let's see what I've got written down here. Paddock 6. So we only do build one more paddock, like I said. Well, we do build more, but we don't use them. So only one more paddock going up, and he's the Baryonyx. And I was going to put the Suchomimus in there with him. But no time. I extend this paddock as well to the right-hand side there, as well as further down. But all the way up until the end of the game, they don't wander down there. So it didn't really help. I was trying to get the Hyangosaurus at 100%. But in the end, if he's comfortable, then I don't care. He's fine. You take a little bit of a welfare hit, but like I mentioned before, I got this welfare done on 52% of the welfare. So just over 5,000-6,000 welfare. I think we needed 14,000 or 16,000, but just over half of the welfare I got, and I still got the trophy. He looks like my cat rubbing on the grass. Here he is, love it to bits. Okay, let's see where we're going from here, guys. What have we got incubating? The Hyangosaurus. Here we go. He is going to this paddock. Again, just bare essentials there with the food on the ground. We're going to get our ranger post in there. The ranger post is a pretty large area. And we're going to add the one ranger station next to us over here. At some point when you've moved your ranger stations around and you've got your paddocks all over the place, I like to pause the game and go to each of the ranger stations and cancel their outpost assignment, and then redo it just to make sure they're all closest ones, and Ranger 1, Ranger 2 aren't going to the same one. It's a good idea to sit back and do that. At the same time, while the game's paused, go through all your amenities as well. I do that every 45 minutes or an hour. I go back to the amenities. Unless I've just bought one, then I kind of tend to it a bit quicker. But otherwise, as you can see here, I'm looking at amenities. I knew this was going to be red because this is where we build a whole lot of amenities, and we do move some building grounds. There we go. We have two amenities down, and the bathroom and the guest building, the shelter. No need to show you that, guys. So that shows you right there what I built. So that's the kind of speed we're going to do. I eventually put a power station over here, because there was nowhere else for me to put it. That was, well, there is, but further down south. And this over here, I end up moving these because I need to put a fence here, because my silly paleo vehicle wasn't getting to paddock one on the left-hand side. That paddock on the top left over there, this paleo is for that paddock and this paddock. And this is where he got stuck. Again, I'm not sure if pulling the fence actually helped, but it couldn't hurt. Or maybe it did hurt, I do not know. But yeah, I guess that's the biggest point I will take away from this. And that's to make sure every paddock, like these two paddocks together, sure, they can use one. But from now onwards, I'm going to have a paleo and a ranger station for every paddock and not let them have to drive very long. I want them in front of the gate every time. And doing so reduces the amount of time, obviously, for them to get to them, to get to the sick animals. It just increases the speed and also reduces the chance of them actually getting glitched and stuff like that. Excuse me. So here we go. Okay, so this one I actually did put to the test. We're putting our final amenity down here by the paddock 6. I did the test on the power, like I said I was going to do in the previous video. What are they called? They're not the substations, the small stations that you can daisy chain, and they're just terrible. I really did try for a long time to use them, but they have to be within a certain distance of each other. That's the overcrowding I was talking about earlier, about the fighter. They keep fighting and just sell one dinosaur until they stop fighting. That's what that was to remind me to say. I really tried to use those power extenders, and it didn't make sense, because if I want to go from this area down to the next area, then I have to build 4 of those things to get there. I don't know why they use those as a substitute for the actual substations. The substations, you can build a wire all the way down, plonk, put a substation, and your shit's powered. But on the other ones, you have to build 4 of those to get to that point. So I don't know why they made that or how useful it is. Maybe if you want to extend, maybe that does make sense. If you want to extend the power just a little bit, and it happens to be within the area of the substation, that makes a lot more sense than I think about it. Yeah, I think I just figured it out. Nice, John. Pat on the back. Nice, nice. Okay, guys, here we go. We are starting the Baryonyx. So we're going to put a fence covering this perfectly right here. Oh, not like that. This is me completing that paddock. I wanted to make it bigger, but it wouldn't let me. There we go. Perfect little paddock in the mountain over there. And we leave that paleo station and the ranger station there. We do eventually build another one on the bottom here. And that's what I was showing here. I was like, this paleo, I'll put a gate that side so they can get in there. And it just didn't work. Look how close that is to that paddock. And they were still getting stuck on the edge of the mountain. So I can't stress enough how I would have a paleo and ranger station for every paddock that I build now dedicated to that paddock. And again, if the paddocks are connected, then you just have gates in between, allowing them to be traversed freely. Okay, again over here, I'm kind of free with the water. As you can see, look at my money go down when I do that. But this is the Baryonyx, and he likes water. And another fail that I do here is I do a tour ride. Again, I'm never doing tour rides ever again unless I'm forced to. Only gyrospheres. I haven't once been a dinosaur being attacking a gyrosphere, but the tour rides, they get attacked all the time. And look at where my path goes through the center of the paddock. Don't do this. Don't put your paddock or your tour ride through the center. Do it on the outskirts of the entire paddock. That's what I would do now, unless it's a gyrosphere. Gyrospheres are smaller. They don't get attacked at all, as far as I know. They might get knocked around, but they roll around. You know, it's a lot easier for them to maneuver than a large truck. So what I take away from that paddock is to only build the gyrospheres, because they do adventure guests, and don't go through the center of the paddock. But I've got so many ideas for my sandbox mode. I just want to unlock every dinosaur, get the platinum, and then go into sandbox mode and just build the world's biggest park ever, and have a lot of fun with that. So here we go. We are building the monorail. I didn't know at the time that, I should have known at the time, the monorail, placing it on a track that's already built will disable the entire track. So again, it's the same as actually placing it and then attaching it. So you're going to lose your transport rating for a little bit. But over here, we are getting to the next little area. So we've got the standard. I like doing a viewing gallery and a tour ride, or now from now on a gyrosphere. Get your toilets up, get your shelter up, get your hotel up. So like every area, every paddock that you do in this map is like its own little town and has all the things that they need to survive. It's the best way of looking at it. We get our shelter in there as well. No need to show it. So this is when I was going towards the Suchomimus, knowing full well that he will be able to cohabitate with the Baryonyx, and we don't even get close to that. I've got the Baryonyx already. It's like one of the first ones you can do on the far left over there, or second far left, and he's ready to go. So we get the Baryonyx in there as soon as possible. But if you want a lot of people to be down there, then you need at least two species. And that's where the guest attraction came in for me. My amenities were only earning 8K down the bottom there that I just built. And like I mentioned, I slapped down the guest attraction and boom, doubled the profit just like that. And that's when I went straight to the research and researched the extra guest attraction modules, which I haven't used once. I always just put one attraction down at the beginning and then leave it. But it's one of those buildings I put within the other buildings now. Like I was saying, each little paddock has its own little town. And along with the shelter and the restrooms, now, bang, I'll put a guest attraction down as well. The cost of the guest attraction compared to the amount that you're getting in, wow, it's massive. Okay, here we go. This is me saying the Baryonyx and Allura Titan, no Lugloon or Paddock 8. So this is me telling you, or telling me at least, that that's all that happens now, are those things. I release a Baryonyx and a Allura Titan. Those are the only two new dinosaurs that I release. And then I build a Lugloon and Paddock 8, which I don't use. So again, I'll show you, but it's going to be way more summarized. At this point as well, if dinosaurs start dying around this point of the game, you want to, like I mentioned before, if one dinosaur dies in a paddock of old age, then go incubate four or five more of that particular dinosaur. And I'm talking about the smaller ones now, not the big ones. The big ones will stay alive the whole time. So the Nodosaurus and the Dilophosaurus and the Chasmosaurus, those will start dying off. Just release three or four into each paddock, or probably a bit more, just to cater for the ones that are dying. And you should be good as gold. But like I said before, the appeal had nothing to do with it. It was so weird. I even had plans here to do the Compsognathus in the paddocks with the carnivores. And I learned in the previous map that I was like, oh, let's just release loads and loads of those guys. It was a massive paddock. I had an Allosaurus or the Albertosaurus in there. And I was like, let's just release as many as we can. Don't. Just release two or three batches. Like, I would say 15 in a larger paddock would be fine. For instance, in the Carnotaurus paddock there, I wouldn't have more than 10 Compsognathus in there, because as small as they are, they still have an area of effect. And that is going to affect the tour rides. So Firestaff end game appeal. So this is a reminder to remind myself that when you are nearing the end of the game and you've got your paddocks up, you've got the paddocks up that I've got over here, if you're following the step-by-step, I fire a lot of staff. So if I fire the 61k, the 31k, that's almost 100k that I'm getting more per minute. And if you are close to getting that profit per minute, then this is what you can do. Once you've researched everything you've researched, so at that point I'd researched the Tylosaurus, I'd researched everything ready for the Lugloon, which we don't even use, and I was able to fire some scientists and increase my profit per minute by a massive amount, but not firing scientists that I know that I would need. So you've got to plan ahead. You've got to know what you're going to release and what kind of genetic value they have, what kind of logistics you're going to need for expeditioning them. This is where they got stuck. As you can see right here, it's actually getting damaged at the same time. I was like, I couldn't click on it. I could only click on it once I went to scanner mode, and then I was able to select it. So I was like, what the F was going on here? So this is when I did build a fence all the way along this path. I moved all the wiring. I don't show it, but I don't even know if that helped in the end. I'm pretty sure I got a glimpse of him still being slow, but that's just another way you can avoid this kind of situation, is to have the dedicated paleomedical and ranger station, which have been like a stuck record, and they're able to go shorter distances. So this is when I increased the size, trying to get the happiness of the Hyangosaurus up, and he just wouldn't. Then not once in the rest of the game do they wander down there. Maybe if I'd put some water down there or something. See, the Amargosaurus is a sauropod. He's like the Brachy family, and he's happy. Then I go to a bloody Hyangosaurus, and he's still 94. Open space. Look at even down the left-hand side, the bottom of the paddock, or the top of the paddock, they don't wander. Just doesn't wander. But 94% is fine. It is sitting under the perfect tab. Those guys have common colds, so that is gonna bit, that's going to get sorted out over time. But that's one thing I'm sure. That's why I'm showing this the first time, is sometimes you get sick dinosaurs like that, but sometimes you get ailments in between, And a lot of the time, I send the paleomedical facility, our building out, sorry, the van out, to heal dinosaurs that are still sick with ailments that you can't treat. Because with the common cold, they will reduce in their health. But if you try and heal them, it just says it's untreatable. But once the cold disappears, you're able to go and heal those dinosaurs. And that's what I did there. There were two dinosaurs I could heal amongst the other ones. So keep that in mind as well. We're looking at 3.5 stars right there. Getting close. Like I said before, we jump quite quickly from 3.8, 3.9 to 5 stars. And over here, I'm looking at the Carcharodontosaurus and don't even get anywhere near a Megalosaurus. We don't get anywhere near that. The Mojungasaurus we've got out already. Baryonyx is the only, well, the second last one. We're going to do the lifespan. We're just putting up the lifespan and humidity. That's pretty much normal for me. If I'm able to, I will put up the resistance over the lifespan, because at this stage of the game, no dinosaurs die. The only ones that die are the ones that I had right at the start, and that is quite good as well. So, having a look at what we're doing there, we're going to get some Baryonyx out. 1.7 million to synthesize is going to be cheap. To incubate is going to be a different story. Alrighty, just over 10 minutes left. Oh, sorry, 20 minutes. Just over 20 minutes. And here we go. Get him done, get him done. There we go. Dead dinosaur. This is what I was mentioning before. The Hyangosaurus is just sick, foot and mouth. And it's going to be the Nodosaurus and the Chasmosaurus. They start dying in waves now. As you can see, they're healing the one. And the one is dead. And he died, let me see, of old age. That's weird. I didn't look. I just assumed it was. Let's see what I was expeditioning for. Mojungasaurus, Baryonyx. I don't think I released the Mojungasaurus. Too expensive. But here comes the Baryonyx into his brand new paddock. And they do cause havoc with the Jurassic Tour. Again, another reason why I'm not going to use Jurassic Tours anymore. I'm going to stick with the gyrospheres. They look better as well. And they get attacked way less frequently. So we had all these buildings deactivated, because I like to build it before the dinosaur gets there. And notice that I haven't built any amenities yet. I'm making sure I've got 10 vehicles on the Jurassic Tour. It's probably too many for this paddock now, I think about it. But adding the Ranger as well. I do build more Ranger and Paleomedical just to the south of that paddock. Well, I build it outside the lagoon, and then I move it from the lagoon that I don't use. As you can see, 1.7 million for the Mojungasaurus. And they've got quite a good appeal. Here comes the first Baryonyx. So, he requires fish, and you're only able to research the piscivore feeder once you have released one. As you can see there, it's the first thing I did after placing the Baryonyx. And again, I was going to put the Suchomimus in here, but no need. He is just having a chill rest straight away. As you can see, his requirements are 100%. He is happy as a Baryonyx in a good paddock. There we go. Contract complete. We'll have a cool mill right there. Thanks for playing. No need to put more water, John. What are you doing? We're doing some more rocks. Oh, because it was just over. So if you release one more Baryonyx in there, all those stats are going to go down a little bit. So that's a good point, actually. If you're looking at a dinosaur that you've just put into a paddock and he's just making the requirements, kind of like where the fish is on that stat, but obviously that's not going to be the fish, then I'd like to put a bit more in, because all those stats are going to reduce for every dinosaur that you put in there. So if you're just making the requirements then, and you're planning on putting more dinos in there, that's a good idea to actually put more than it's actually showing at the time. Okay, large hotel. We are going to place, we're probably going to skip ahead here. There we go. We're going to put him right down there. And we have archaeology on site. We'll take the million and public rating 25. Thanks for playing. We don't care that it's 4 times the time. Definitely worth the money and the public rating. Okay, so over here now, we're going to remove the water, which is over there. I think this is when I do mess around with the extension. Then I'm like, nope, not going to work at all. We're just going to stick with the substations. I think I was trying to get to the water. The water removal tool. Okay, going back to the center. The Mojungasaurus is coming up now. And we've got two Mojungas coming into this paddock. I think from about this point onwards, if you watch the stars, they start to increase quite dramatically, quite quickly. See, 308 appeal. Antisocial is fine. No ailments with him. So 3.5 stars. And these guys are happy, happy. Yes, they are. We've got two more coming in there. Dilophosaurus, no need. He is sick, but we're not showing that stuff. Piscivore feeder, release 5 dinosaurs with strong trait. Oh, that's Piscivore's 2. So that was me waiting for the Suchomimus to go in with the Baryonyx. And you see I put some trees over there. I couldn't resist it. But here we're putting the 102, which is quite low. And this is the area that I do the guest attraction, guys. So even though it was 103 guests, which is probably too little for a large amenity, I put it down anyway because I knew I was going to release more dinosaurs into this paddock as well as an extra species. And that's going to increase the flow of traffic down here. But let's see. I actually just put one down for starters. And then I wanted to see if it was able to get a profit. And sure, it's able to get a profit, but how much profit is the question? So we're going to keep going down. Now, if nothing else works after one or two additions, then you know you're lacking heavily in the guests. As you can see, 105 guests. And this is when I tried the guest attraction, which I'm going to show you in a second. So we're going to do some more Baryonyx here. We still can't take away the negative ailment. All we're doing is changing the skin. Like I said, I like to do before. Only 500k for the synthesis of him. Let's see what else we got going here. The humble trait definitely reduces the environmental needs. I love that one. Okay, Baryonyx, go. Push X. Thank you. You see, I got a few more scientists there. I started hiring more when I started getting some more cash in. And then we're going to fire them straight away as well. So we've got some Mutterbuttersaurus going there. I wanted to top up those paddocks, like I was saying before. Top up all your old paddocks as well at the same time as doing the main new paddock that you're doing. Always a good idea. As you can see, I'm never really rolling in the cash in this. I'm always kind of on par. And if I'd wanted to have more money a lot of the time, but just taking a lot longer, I would have fired more scientists and then just waited. But now I've been fast forwarding so much and making sure I've got all the scientists I need to do the following. But at this stage of the game now, there's nothing else that I do. Nothing else that I research. Or very few things that I research. And here's the whole waste of time. There's no need to do any of this lagoon. I build the lagoon. I build the hatchery. I build Paleo Center. I build the ranger station. I don't show any of that, guys. I don't show anything to do with the lagoon because it never, ever came into play, unfortunately. Yeah, so that's late stage. No need to do any of that. So here we go with the amenities. And again, this is when I show quite specifically how much they're earning before and how much they're earning after the guest attraction. And it's like, it's instant. And I've been on it. I know I've been going on about it like a stuck record, but it's definitely something I'm going to do all the time now. I'm going to add it to my little town, as in, like I was saying before, the hotel, the shelter, the bathroom, the amenities, and the guest attraction. And the monorail, obviously. So I was going to save here because I wasn't quite sure. Oh, that's the storm, that's why. So again, the storm. You got the money to get through it. Use the helicopter to take some photos. See here, this is a strange one to have. You want to fix the shelters straight away. You can't have the shelters disabled for 5 minutes while there's a storm for 5 minutes. Your park will go to shit in 2 seconds. So be careful of that. But after the storm passes and you've repaired everything, we're going to see how much we're going to earn here before and after the guest attraction. Let's have a look, see. There comes the storm. So here we've got 1,000. Let's see what we're earning.
It has been noted.
Low health. I should be pausing things now. So very, very low amount, as you can see there, only $1,000. Now we're going into super summary mode, guys, where I'm pretty much summarizing the last hour, hour and a half of the game. This is when all the scientists got unrested by the storm. That was one of the options. And we're going to go back down. See what kind of earnings we're getting. So again, no need lagoon hatchery, no need for any of this at all. It was a nice little lagoon there. I don't think it would have been enough for the Tylosaurus, but a couple of other marine reptiles over here as well. This is where I built the fence to try and help him from going through there. And it's weird that would be kind of a glitch. I mean, it's the edge of a map, so what, the van's still driving. And this is when I build a fence again to try and, you know, coerce it around. And I'm not even sure if it did work in the end. I couldn't tell you. I don't think I came back to it. But I think they were still stuck against the wall anyway. But let's have a look at the amenities here now. So we've got 1,000, 1,000, 1,000, even less. Look at that, eh? boosted up there. Bring it on. 1.4 mil. Bring it on. So again, we're just looking at something that can be done automatically. Number of guests, sure, why not? Build hotels and that's done. So we do a massive expansion now, which in the end wasn't necessary. I pulled a paddock down here as well, which isn't necessary. As you'll see, I do summarize it, but no need to show the whole thing. I put it across here. I go all the way around the edges. Probably could have shown less than this as well. But, and now, there we go. Couldn't get around there for some reason. So this was going to be the, what was I going to put in here? I think it was, damn it, Gigantospinosaurus maybe. I'm not sure what I was going to put in that paddock, but I had him ready. Had him ready to go, and then the five-star popped. So this is all the buildings from the unused lagoon area, which I'm just going to move to this paddock down here, which we don't use. And in the end, these got used for the Baryonyx paddock right there, instead of sharing them with the other one. So the paleo medical from the lagoon, we're going to move as well. Absolute waste of time that was. Can't remember what dinosaur I was going to put in that paddock. But we disabled everything else over here and moved what we could use from building the useless lagoon. Yeah, the Just the Ranger outpost, make sure that, like I mentioned before, that you've got the Ranger outpost going to the closest one to them. Because I've built these two over here. This is for the Baryonyx, but I've got a ranger station on the far left-hand side up top there by the Carnotaurus that's currently using that ranger station as well. So make sure you got those on the ones as close as possible. Now, we don't want to discard the eggs. So again, to top up the Notosaurus is so cheap and quick and easy. Chasmosaurus, Notosaurus, and the Hyangosaurus, and some Dilophosaurus as well is going to die. Pristine fossils. 1 million. We will have that. That's going to push us through. What are we on? 3.5 stars now. That's going to jump up very quickly. 330k. Even at the end of the game, that should be way more than that. It's because I hired more scientists. And I wanted to speed things up. So over here, trying to get to, showing again that this over here, we want to use, change this ranger station to the outpost only on the right. And we have a sick dino over there in treatment. And let's see what else we're going to do. So we do build one more paddock, which we kind of use. We throw some Olero Titans in there, and it's done. So this point over here, I built that fence as well. But as you can see, he's still stuck there. I think he is. Yeah, he is. So I'm not sure if building the fence helped. But to get around it, like I've been saying the whole video, just to put it as close as you can to the paddock. Moving buildings if you have to. Okay, so this is the start of the final paddock that I built. And I spent so much time preparing the area, once again, building my little town. And when I say that, I mean like the shelters, the bathrooms, amenities, hotel, guest attraction, and the monorail. All in this area right here. Then I had plans for another paddock in the round area, just at the top of the screen as well, there on the right. And we built the monorail station, just to the left. That paddock we don't use. I was going to put Suchomimus in with Baryonyx. Didn't get a chance to do that either. But the trophy popped pretty quickly. I think I get an option, a 1.5 times the ticket sale cost. And my profits went up loads very quickly. And I don't even remember what the negative ailment or negative sabotage effect was for that. I don't even think there was one. See, I was heading for the Ankylosaurus, which is the last one on that list, thinking I would have the time to get there, which was a bit silly. But here, the Hadrosaur, we've got the Suntalosaurus. We're going to go back and release that for my Platinum Trophy. Corythosaurus, and there's the Olora Titan. Now, he had the most appeal out of those three, so I went with him. But we have to do the Corythosaurus first. Let's see, reach park rating 4.3 stars. And here we have the guest attraction modules. I was all for this now, whereas before I was like empty that building. Now I'm all for that building. And it's just, you have to research that if you want to do more than one, because the cinema is the standard one. And not that appeal rating matters, but you'll only get half the appeal for a guest building that you've duplicated. So research that if you wanna. And let's have a look at what we're doing down here. So we've got this whole area set up. We've got, we're gonna do another guest attraction. Here we go. So let's have a look at this. We're getting 1 to 2,000. profit on those buildings. So they're 6,000, 6,000, 4,000. So 664 from this angle. And we're going to show you now how much it went up. So we're going to put in anyone that that isn't done before. I think I went with mini golf, though, probably fossil zone, maybe arcade. Let's see where we go with this. Mini golf lab tour it is. That's what I would go on. So after that's done, let's see, 16,000, 16,000 and 15,000. So it went up 10, 10 and 9,000, even more, 11,000. So, I mean, that's 30,000 profit a minute just for putting that guest attraction down there. And that's when I was like, wow, did you see that? And yeah, I did see it. So guest attractions are part of my little town settings now, if you will. And they're going to be a big part of my future plays, because that is a monstrous profit, more profit than adding more dinosaurs, let's be honest. So definite hands, yes. Okay, we've only got about 10 minutes more. We're going to summarize what we've done here. So again, this area, guys, I'm going to build my little town. And again, that just means the shelter, toilets, amenities, the monorail. We could build a monorail just outside the ranger station and the paleo medical facility. We're going to put over here because I was going to have a paddock on the right-hand side of this. I think that's why I've got a fence across there now. I think I put a fence across there at some point just so I don't go across it. And again, just a reminder to keep topping up your old paddocks. Don't neglect them. Your dinosaurs will die. And this big paddock in the middle with the Dilophosaurus, there's, you can have so many. I don't think I ever once saw a fight with these guys. Whereas in the first game, I never used them because the storms drove them mad and they fought. But this one, you can have a very small paddock with a lot of Dilophosaurus in them. And they're definitely worth it in this game. So here it comes, the last dinosaur we're going to actually synthesize and incubate. We've got a humble trait there, which is always good. Minus 30% environmental needs is massive. And let's hope he's alpha, which means it'll be applied to everyone. I think we're going to fire some scientists soon as well. So this is the point when we go from 3.8 stars to 5 stars very quickly. You can see 3.8 right there. I mean, I think I wasn't even paying attention to the stars. And when I looked down there, one time I was like 3.8 or 3.7 where it is now. And then the next time I looked at it, I was 4.9. And I was like, how the hell did that happen? And it was from the ticket sales. But I'm not too worried about that because this strategy will still work, this gameplay, if you're following it step by step, because I did have plans for other big dinosaurs or amounts of dinosaurs in these paddocks. And again, with the Alora Titan here in paddock, I don't think I've got it on there. Not yet, paddock 8, I think it is. We're going to have the Stegosaurus and the Ankylosaurus in there as well. So those two were lined up and those species are fine together. Might have just come short on the feeding, but we will see. So here it is. Now watch my star rating, guys. We're pretty much on 4 stars. Now we're going to increase for 15 minutes, 1.5. So we're on 3.9 stars. And then I'm going to fast forward, skip ahead, and boom. Look at that. Look how much it went up right there. If you didn't see that, go back. Look at that. That is just real time as well, guys. That went up almost half or 0.6 stars. Look at that. Still going up. Still going up. And this is all real time. That's why I put the profit boost there. So if you want to get your 5 stars... Look at that, I went from 3.9 to 4.8 in 15 seconds. And that is insane. That's just insane. And that's my new favorite thing ever. And I'm sure it is fast-forwarded now. But that's all it took, guys. If you don't get that, then remember, Stegosaurus in here, Alora Titan, Ankylosaurus, and then the Suchomimus with the Baryonyx in that paddock. That's what I had planned ahead. But the trophy pops for me pretty damn quickly. As you can see, I've gone back down to 4.2 stars now that the ticket sales has gone back to normal, I'm assuming. And it's still going down to 4 stars. But releasing the Alora Titan, 3.9 stars now. So it does boost it for a little bit. If you're closer, if I was 1 point or 0.2 closer to 5 stars, I would have got the trophy right there. It would have boosted me over the edge. But I'm glad it didn't because I wanted to show you what I was doing here. Again, hotel, guest attraction, amenities, shelter, toilets, ranger station, paleo medical, making its own little town complete and hassle-free. And we're going to put what's going to be on this one. I would say mini-golf. I always like a good game of putt-putt, we call it. Mini-golf. It's going to be the arcade. Sure, why not? We're all gamers here. And then we're going to have a look at the power supply again. You're not going to need to show this, but you see I've got a fence across there on the right-hand side. That is just to remind me that's the start of the next paddock, so that's the space I can use. And I didn't even get a chance to use it. See, over here I was going to go delete the lagoon, and then I was like, no, don't delete the lagoon, because we're going to load this game and come release dinosaurs or reptiles that we haven't done before. And it was the second one there, the Liliopodion or something, that I need to release. So I'm going to come back and release that for my platinum. Sabotage power loss, that was for taking the 1.5 ticket sales. But again, look at it, we've gotten 4.5 stars now after the Laura Titan. When they sabotage the power supply like this, all you have to worry about really is the gates. All your fences are now concrete if you follow the guide. And the gates are the only thing that dinosaurs can escape from once they are sabotaged. Coming up to the end of it now, guys. All our service buildings over there still. Looking good, looking good. Let's reboot the power stations. Down here is looking good. Lagoon, waste of time. We've got our monorail set up over here now. Okay, we're coming down to the end of it. 4.3 stars. Now we're going to place some amenities. As we can see there, 102 guests, 124, 146 is good. 148 is fine for a food amenity, a large amenity at least. We're going to get our profit per minute coming up pretty quickly now with these amenities. Even with only just the Alora Titan in that one paddock, it still does it. As you can see there, I'm still topping up the Nodosaurus and the Chasmosaurus paddock, the first paddock we built. Dinosaurs are dying. There's no need to... there is a massive need to top them up, because you'll just little chisel away at your appeal. And in the end, like I was saying, the appeal meant absolutely nothing on this run. 4.7 stars, so as soon as these amenities are up and running and the profit comes in, that should pop me over the 5 star. Dilophosaurus, look at that. 8 of 8 eggs. We will have it. 2.4 million. I'm like, yeah, let's just do it. So we removed the ones with no traits. As you can see, there are no negative traits, but we just removed the ones that have no traits. Not that it's going to make any difference in the next 5 minutes or 4 minutes of my 5 stars. So 4.7 stars. We're waiting for those amenities to kick in. You see those guys attacking the tour rides all the time, whereas the gyrosphere, they're not. Almost on 5 stars, 30% on last month, which is a massive jump. On the late stages of the game. Deathmatch, no. Photox, no. Modified dinosaur genome, no, it doesn't really matter. Just whatever we do, it doesn't matter. We're going to release that large amount of Dilophosaurus again. I don't know why I always like to watch them come out. Didn't look like I changed the skin. That's a lot of dinos coming out there, and that's probably going to take me to 5 stars, thinking about it, which is weird, because the appeal didn't have anything to do with it. So releasing dinosaurs was weird. So 4.9 stars, I was like, holy shit! When did I get that? There we go. You call that a challenge. So we're going to do a quick summary of what was to come as well. If you're struggling to get that last little step. 7 hours, 1 minute, less than half the part time they want you to do it. So absolutely smashed it. Super stoked with that time, and I'm super amped to get my platinum today on this. Let's go and have a look at what we did. I think we do a bit of a summary now. So in the first paddock, we had the Nodosaurus and the Chasmosaurus from the start. Those are the wild dinosaurs right there. Paddock 2, we had the Dilophosaurus only. Oh, sorry, that's paddock 3. No, that's paddock 5. No, that's paddock 6, damn it. The Hyangosaurus and the Mungosaurus we got in there. That's paddock 6. Then paddock 2 right there, Dilophosaurus, the only Dilophosaurus. And you can put a lot of them in there as well. Very cool dinosaur in Jurassic World 2, not 1. Here we had the Muttamuttosaurus and the Kendrosaurus. Together, happy family right there. Then paddock 4, Carnotaurus. Again, I might do one less in there if I did it again. Paddock 5, Mojangosaurus right there. Good stuff. Paddock 7, we have the Baryonyx right there. Paddock 8, we got nothing. We were going to do the Allosaurus in there. Lagoon, absolutely nothing for us in there. And then paddock 8, we've got the Alora Titan, where we're going to put the Stegosaurus and the Ankylosaurus in there at the same time. And I'm showing it here, I think it is, to remind me what it was. Where is it? There it is, Stegosaurus and the Ankylosaurus right next to it. They will be fine together. There we go. So that's it, guys. I really hope you enjoyed the content. If you have any questions at all, just ask me. It took a long time to create and edit this video, so please smash that like button for me, guys, if you enjoy the content, and subscribe if you are really enjoying it. And just a last reminder about that share play. If you have any trophies at all what you're trying to get, you can email me from the description, and I can help you get those trophies. So thanks so much for watching, guys. I want to catch you on the next one.